So we come to the equation of a line in space, okay? And space is not that space, interstellar space or whatever. By space, we are just trying to distinguish between a plane, which was a 2D figure, and a 3D figure. So you could have pretty well written it as in three dimension, okay? So it is three dimension. Because space is something that occupies volume, correct? And if it is occupying a volume, it means it is 3D. Only 3D things can occupy a volume. For example, this board, not the whole board, because it has got some thickness, just this surface is not it's not occupying any volume, okay? Just the surface. The board itself, anything that you see around, if you can see it, it has to be a 3D. It is quite another matter that you ignore the thickness and then say that it is a 2D. For example, this page may be considered as a 2D. Why? Because as compared to its dimension of length and breadth here, the thickness is very, very, very small. So we consider it to be a 3D. But just try to think, if you can see it, it just cannot be a 2D. Absolutely, technically speaking. Okay, technically speaking, it has to have some thickness for it to even exist. Okay, if the thickness is absolutely zero, it will vanish into thin air, right? It will be nothing. Okay, so even a polythene that we are using as a carry bag, though it's very thin, still it has got some thickness. Okay, measurable by say a micrometer. Okay, but it is defined like that. How many micron? Polythenes are very thin objects. They are defined in micron thickness. Micron is micrometer. Okay. So 100 micron. Normally, the polythenes that we use are 100 micron. So that is 10 to the power minus 4 meters. So if you multiply it by 1000, it gets converted into millimeters. So it is 1/10 of a millimeter. Okay. 1/10 of a millimeter. That means if you put 10 such together, it will be 1 millimeter thick. But it has thickness, obviously. Okay? So, fine. So, once that is understood, our line has to be a unique one, right? If you are trying to write the equation of a line, then it has to be a unique line. And there are two ways in which line can be unique, okay? There are many more ways, but we are going to learn two ways. So, a line can be unique if number one, see, it is parallel to a given vector. Okay, it is parallel to a given vector, but parallel to a given vector, if this is a vector, parallel to a given vector, there will be infinite number of lines. Okay, this is everywhere in the space, all the lines are which are parallel to it, they will be all satisfying this condition. Then how does it, unique line is when you can say yes, this is one line which satisfies this, unique one. Okay, if there are so many, you will not be able to write the equation of so many, right? So another condition should be, it is parallel to a given vector and it should pass through a given point, is it not? It should pass through a given point. The moment you apply this condition, you force it to follow this condition, immediately the line becomes unique. Because if I say it should be passing through 2, 3, 4, then all the lines won't pass. So you keep on taking the parallel ones and yes, one line which passes, that becomes a unique line. That means that is only one line. Out of all those infinite lines, there will be only one line that will be satisfying that condition. okay. Now we are in a position to find out the equation of that, okay. So one is that, and the other is that if it passes through two given points, okay, those two points are also unique, they are passing through two given points, fine. They are passing through two given points, fine. So if two points are given, Euclid has told us, Euclid's geometry class 9, you have studied that through two given points there is only one line that can be drawn, so immediately the line becomes unique, okay. Now if we apply the concept of vector, you will see how quickly the equation of the line is in front of you and in a vector form, and immediately it can be converted into a Cartesian form, okay. So we will do the first one. Line parallel to a given vector and passing through a given point, okay. So this is my first passing through a given point, right. Now let us see, see what happens. So this is my 3D space, and this is, let us say, my line. This is my line, okay. Now this given vector, conventionally in this book we'll be treating as B, and the point that is given, that the position vector of that we'll be taking as A. Now at the outset I want to tell you that A, B, C in the scalar version are reserved for direction ratios. Don't start getting confused that this B has to do something with that direction ratio and this A has to do something with direction ratio A. No. Okay. If I was given a choice, I would have named this R1 actually, and I would have named this as say another vector M, because that will create a confusion, you will see. But at the outset you should understand that it is just coincidental that they are naming it A and B, and maybe they are picking up the point as the first alphabet and the vector as the second alphabet. That's all. That is where the coincidence, that is where the similarity ends. Fine. Now, so there is a vector B, okay. So there is a vector B to which this line is parallel. Correct. This line is parallel, and there are strange things that happen in a line in 3D. In a 2D, what happens if two lines are not parallel? They intersect. If they are parallel, they do not intersect. Here, that is not the case. These two pens, they are not parallel. Okay, they are not parallel, but still they will not intersect. These lines are called skew lines. okay. So, so these are the two parallel lines, see, and their direction ratios will always be the same. So things are a bit different in 3D, okay, and you should start thinking in terms of 3D. Because why? It's simpler to think in terms of 3D. Why? Because we're living in a 3D environment. Every moment that you're here, you yourself are a 3D object. It's not. You're a 3D object. Fine. So it's more convenient for us to think in terms of 3D, though it is difficult to draw a diagram on the 2D that represents the 3D. So you should maybe pick up some sticks and start imagining things in this very space. Okay. So this is my B vector. Fine. Now my A, this point is this. So this line is passing through that. So I say that there is this. Okay. This is my vector A, the position vector. Fine. So I'll write it something like this. So A, this is my position vector. Now what do I do in 2D? When we were trying to find a line, we always find a general point. Okay. Now this A, this point here, let us call this A. What will be the coordinate of this A? I call this x1, y1, z1. So the coordinate of this is x1, y1, z1. You understand? That point to which it points, the position vector A, that is x1, y1, z1. And what do? We always take a general point on the line that we used to take as x comma y. So you'll find all the equations, equation of a line in terms of x and y, equation of a circle, x square plus y square is equal to a square, or x minus a whole square plus y minus b whole square is equal to r square, or a parabola, y square is equal to 4x, or a hyperbola, x square upon a square minus y square upon b square is equal to 1, or an ellipse, x square upon a square plus y square upon b square is equal to 1, correct? It will always involve that general point. So here I name that as R vector, and the coordinate of this point R I designate as x, y, z. Okay, I designate it as x, y, z. Now you see, what is the vector that connects the A and R? What is that vector? We have already studied the vector joining the two points. So if I want this, it is R minus A. What is my vector R minus A? My R minus A vector is this, the green one. Do we realize that? So that green one, and I write it in green, is my R minus A vector. Now is that vector parallel to B?
Yes, yes.
It has to be. And it will be so even if R slides anywhere here. The only thing is that so let me first of all write the condition for. So R minus A vector is, well, let me write it like that. What is my R vector first of all? How can I write it? X I cap plus Y J cap plus Z K cap. You were there in that class. Huh? What is my A vector? X1 I cap, y1 j cap, z1 k cap. Correct?
my vector b is given as ai cap plus bj cap plus ck cap. Here the abc's are direction ratios, because we have been saying that whatever is the coefficient of I cap is always the direction ratio, and J cap is always the direction ratio of cos beta LMN, LK, MK and LK, fine. So again, don't confuse. So this ABC are this time direction ratio. So I'll write this ABC are direction ratios. X1, Y1, Z1 is a fixed point, so it may be 2, 3, 4. That will be given to you.
They are not
the direction ratio. X1, Y1, Z1 is direction ratio of this, yes. It is. It is the direction ratio of this. Whenever you represent a vector like this, then their I, J, K coefficients do indeed represent the direction ratios. The direction ratios. So now I say if R minus A is parallel to B, then I get R minus A is equal to lambda B. That's all. If I am in this portion to the right of this point, then lambda is a positive quantity. If I go to the left, it becomes a negative quantity. That's all. So it is a constant. It's a scalar. Where lambda is a scalar. Lambda is a scalar. That's all. Now, the moment you put these values here and equate the x, y, z, immediately you get it in the Cartesian form. So this is your vector form. Or maybe I'll use a red pen. So this is the vector form of the equation. Now the moment I plug in the vectors on both the sides, I have the vectors ready with me, so let us plug it in. So I write xi cap plus yj cap plus zk cap minus x1i cap plus y1j cap plus z1k cap r minus a is equal to lambda times A I cap plus B J cap plus C K cap. So it gives me X minus X1 I cap plus Y minus Y1 J cap plus Z minus Z1 K cap is equal to lambda A I cap plus lambda B J cap plus lambda C C K cap. Okay? Now, so we are utilizing all those small tidbits of vectors that we have learned. We said the two vectors are equal if and only if their I, J, K coefficients are equal. So let us equate it, right? So I say X minus X1 is equal to lambda A and Y minus Y1 is equal to lambda B and Z minus Z1 is equal to lambda C. Correct? So I write it here. So what does it give me? It gives me x minus x1 upon a is equal to lambda, y minus y1 upon b is equal to lambda, z minus z1 upon c is equal to lambda. So I get that x minus x1, so I get x minus x1 upon a is equal to y minus y1 upon b is equal to z minus z1 upon c. This is your Cartesian form of the equation. From where have I got this? From the vector form. Did it take me even a second to write the vector form? No. Okay. No. It did not take me even a second to write the vector form. So what happens is from here I can directly get that. Okay. R minus A, in your mind you should understand this is X minus X1 equating to A, X minus X1 upon A. So X minus the X coordinate of the point
divided by the L.